Before I begin, let me start by saying, when this movie came out, my mama said it was evil. And 15 years later, she died. The star of our movie today is... Harry, you've grown so much. It's almost like they waited too long to make this movie. Play! Our story begins with Harry, all alone in his room, reminiscing about the good old days and wondering why he ain't heard a word from a single witch all summer. And Harry's like, I can't let you out, Hedwig. I can't use magic outside school. Well, damn, Bert, there's a key right there in the lock. Why don't you use some hocus pocus to morph your ass into something with strength and the opposable thumbs? And Uncle Sponge and Aunt Spiker are having some dinner guests, just in time for this chihuahua on crack to show up and F it all up. Okay, pause. Two things here. Could that hand-drawn picture of Dudley get any creepier? And two, I wasn't aware Hogwarts pimped their merchandise to their own students. Back to this thing that calls himself an elf. Nobody told him elf's supposed to look like Orlando Bloom, not some bug-eyed Billy Joel frontin' motherfucker. So he intercepts all of Harry's letters and he tells Harry he ought not go to Hogwarts because something bad's gonna happen. But we know Harry gonna go anyway because otherwise the movie would end right here and ain't nobody gonna pay $6.50 for a 4-minute, 10-second movie about a boring British orphan with nothing but a school pride sticker and an owl with no hands. $9.07 adjusted for inflation. Then Dobby dumps cake on some bitch's head, Uncle Vernon puts Harry in a little sorcerer's solitary confinement, and the Weasleys perform a prison break in a flying car because that's exactly what Joe knew they would need to pull bars off a second story window. Convenient, I know. Off to the Weasleys, where Harry encounters his future wife who looks exactly like his mummy. Your dead mummy? Oh, I see, mummy issues, mummy! Where he also meets Ron's daddy who devotes his life to studying normal people. What's the function of a rubber duck? I guess you could say its sole purpose was to witness Bert and Ernie's escapades. That poor rubber ducky. Off to school shopping on Diagon Alley, and what's the point of wearing nice clothes if you're just gonna go getting all ashy? The questions run too deep for such a simple man. This looked like that alley where Fontaine got her teeth pulled out and caught the cooties. Until he gets out and finds Hermione who goes saying, Oculus Reparo. Maybe they could improve Dobby's looks and help him by getting that monkey off his back with something like, look like Orlando Bloomo DiDruggio. Enter Dennis Quaid, Wizard Edition. Don't you love how every time somebody say his name, he look like he ain't never heard it before? I am Harry f***ing Potter? What, you think folks gonna see that scar on your face and say, crack it, it's Luke Perry. God rest his soul. I see how it is. You've been wearing your cousin's hand-me-down underwear so long you check inside the waistband and think your name is Dudley. All you gotta know about Gilderoy is two things. He's the new Defense Against the Dark Arts teacher, and he's a douche. Poor Harry can't even go into a damn bookstore without getting harassed by Iceman and Iceman Senior with longer hair, getting accused of coming to a bookstore just to get attention. Well, that's not creepy at all. Pull me in and use your little snaky cane to reveal my private thing. God forbid you understand personal space. And it was at this moment that Harry understood exactly why Draco is so effed up. So Malfoy Sr. slips a book to Harry's future wife, which Harry doesn't mention because otherwise the movie would end right here and ain't nobody gonna pay $6.50 for a 21-minute, 16-second movie about a boring British orphan who wears his cousin's hand-me-down drawers with nothing but a school pride sticker, an owl with no hands, and a penchant for girls that look like his mummy. $9.07 adjusted for inflation. So at the train station, the wall blocks Harry and Ron, who then have to fly the car to Hogwarts where they get assaulted by that wampin' willow, the spanking shrub, the f*** you up fern. And Ron breaks his wand because he's hooked. McGonagall acts a witch, and Dumbledore doesn't give his usual pre-term introduction, but if he did, it would sound something like this. Gryffindor, you the bomb. Hufflepuff, you could do better, a lot better. Ravenclaw, you a bunch of tryhards. Slytherin, you a bunch of underage s***s. Later, Harry hears voices in the wall, and then they all discover that bit cat that tattles on everybody done turned rigor mortis. Oh, how very nice of you, entire school, to arrive just in time to behold this gory scene of very superstitious writings on the wall and rigid kitties. In Transfiguration class, McGonagall teaches the students how to turn animals into inanimate objects, because don't you want to drink out of your dog? All I see is the early years of school where they still try to teach the children that learning is fun. And Hermione is like, hey Catwoman, tell us about that Chamber of Secrets thingy. Damn, she was just trying to teach y'all how to have some wacky fun turning your frog into a flask, but you gotta go do you. So McGonagall's like, as you all know, student safety is a top priority here at Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry, though we regret to inform you that there was this one wizard named Slytherin who didn't like mutts, and there may or may not be a hidden basement chamber thingy where there may or may not be a monster who may or may not like to off all of y'all who ain't born of pure breeds So if you want to save your ass, you best have your license and registration and your AKC papers handy, especially you, Hermione, and while you're at it, see a groomer. Okay, let's speed this up. Hermione concocts a potion to turn Harry and Ron into Malfoy's toadies. Harry stops the snake from killing a Hufflepuff, which is a total waste of time. The Hufflepuff accuses Harry of setting the snake on him. I told you it was a total waste of time. Stupid f***ing Hufflepuffs, what the s*** they good for? Harry starts hearing that voice in the wall again saying, Masha, Masha, Masha. Then Harry goes to Dumbledore's office and has a conversation with that cranky ass hat. Cranky ass hat, not cranky ass hat. You know what, both apply. Then the bird spontaneously combusts and Harry just sit there like, more shit I'm gonna get blamed for. But then Dumbledore explains that in the same manner in which he come f***ing busts, he also suddenly re-f***ing births. And conveniently drops the knowledge that the tears of these inflammatory AVs have healing properties which might be useful if you, I don't know, get bitten by a giant snake? I don't know the f***ing rules. Half the student f***ing body is petrified, but who give a s*** at Christmas time? And finally, Hermione finishes the potion to turn Harry and Ron into Malfoy's toadies after they hover some tasties spiked with a sedative in front of them. And you know them roly-polies can't resist. Then Hermione makes Harry and Ron drink some bosh she tries to pass off as smoothies. Since Harry and Ron are wearing the toady robes, they must have left those two lying around somewhere in their tighty-whities. I'm assuming. So they get up in Slytherin's crib, and guess what they find out? Nothing. Meanwhile, Hermione accidentally swallows some student's cat hair, and no, I do not mean that like it sounds. Harry finds Tom Riddle's diary in the bathroom. Why do Harry's best adventures often take place in his pajamas? And the moral of this story is... What's the moral of this story? We find out why Hagrid can't spell simple words like happy and can be trusted with little more than bumming off the school. I'm telling y'all, I think he's the janitor. Walk around the grounds all day saying shit like, Dumbledore let me live here so I'm a hood graph afraid. Then somebody wrecks the joint and steals Tom Riddle's diary that probably ain't turning up nowhere but a hawk shop in Westminster. Well, it look like Hermione gonna be useless for a while. It look like Hagrid gonna be in the pokey for a while. I always know where you are, Muffin. Then they do what Hagrid said while they were hiding and they follow the spiders and find themselves up creek without a flying gear. Cliche! And Ron's like, what was the point of that? And Harry's like, to find out Hagrid is innocent. Well, f***ing yeah! He ain't smart enough to commit a crime. Gilderoy gets tasked with killing the giant snake under the shitter. He tries to argue in an OFT, but the Snoops find his ass out. And then he admits he ain't never done any of the amazing shit he wrote about in those books. And Harry and Ron force Gilderoy to the porta potty at wand point. Then Gilderoy tries to erase their memories so he can pull off a Houdini and vanish, but he uses Ron's broken wand, which bounces the spell back on himself. Ha ha, ha ha ha, ha ha. Dumb bit. Then there's some avalanche which traps Ron outside the chamber because if Harry had any help down there, this wouldn't be nearly as interesting. Not that it is anyway, but they trying. Down there, he finds his future wife is half dead near the seas, close to Modus. Then Tom gives his boring bad guy monologue. And I'm just gonna shorten this and say he says, blah, 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 blah. And this right here, this is one of those which came first, the chicken or the egg kind of situations. Did Joe first write, I am Lord Voldemort, and then see what kind of name she could come up with and was like, oh yeah, Tom Riddle, that's real. Then catch yourself going, well, what the happy horse shit am I supposed to do with A-M-L-O-V-O-R? Well, she could have stuck with that and he'd have been Tom M. Lorvo Riddle. Or she could have gone with Tom Lamrovo Riddle. Or Tom Bamrolo Riddle, which sounds like some kind of candy mama would put in the Christmas stocking. Hey mama, you did get me some damn Bamrolos for my stocking, right? I love my stocking, it's fuzzy red and it said Jeb and gold on it. A die on the back. Well anyway, the best joke could come up with was Marvolo and she crossed her little crumpet clenching fingers and hoped nobody looked at her like this. But we did anyway. So anyway, the bursting flame bird flies down and drops the cranky ass hat just in time for this old man statue thing to turn Gene Simmons. And the bird pecks on that big giant snake thing's head and turns him Ray Charles. Then Harry has to get stealthy and hide from the big sneaky serpent because he can still hear him and technically should still be able to smell him, but this is a kids movie. Then there's a long fight. Scam. You know they killed a real basilisk for this scene. Where is Peter? Where is the ASPCA? Then we learn that the one thing that can destroy a Horcrux is a poisonous basilisk fang or anything with giant snake vent. I don't know the f***ing rules. Then we learned that the one thing that can heal Basilisk fang stabs is tears from explosive AVs. Convenient, I know. Then we learned that the one thing that can free an elf that don't look like Orlando Bloom is a dirty, smelly, foot fungus-ridden sock, I don't know the f***ing rules. And some shit about Iceman Senior, Hermione getting unfroze, and Hagrid being acquitted. And as far as I'm concerned, that's the end. Be sure to like, share, and subscribe for your regular fix of meth. You can expect me to upload more videos after I make sure Mama put some damn bam Rolos in my stocking. And a special thank you to these aficionados, addicts, and experts. Jennifer P., Cameron T., Star Kitten, Isabel, Dissy, Chris O., Dan W., David C., Whiskey, Melissa S., Nettie J., and Gabriella C. For more is explained for, I am Lord of Dire. And unlike Joe, I ain't gonna try and reorganize that shit into a real name.